Jesse and his 5-year-old son were driving past a cemetery when his son happened to notice a very large pile of dirt next to a freshly dug grave. Jesse cried out, "Look, Dad, one of them got out!" You know, it's easy to understand how a small boy who's never seen an open grave might jump to the wrong conclusion. Our world has so many zombie movies, an open grave could be a start of a Hollywood horror movie. But empty graves are not always a sign of a Hollywood horror movie. In fact, this weekend we're celebrating an empty grave. The first fruits of the empty graves, when Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the first fruits alive from the grave. This is not a horror film in the making. This is good news. This is great news. And we're continuing our series of sermons on God Knows How to Party, looking at Jewish feasts as found in Leviticus 23, looking at the Feast of First Fruits that God commanded the Israelites to keep. It's a feast like Passover and like the unleavened bread. It points ahead to Jesus Christ, who is going to be the ultimate fulfillment of the first fruits. Today, both Jared and I will be preaching on this passage. It's kind of a tag team preaching. We decided that the old guy gets to do the Old Testament and the new guy gets to do the New Testament. It works out really good. We let the young guy take care of the best news of everything, Jesus Christ being the first fruit of the for Christians, first fruit from the dead. But first, let's begin with prayer. Lord, we are thankful. We're thankful for your love. We're thankful for the blessings you give to us. And we thank you, Lord, that Jesus is that fulfillment of the first fruits. Help us, Lord, to understand what the first fruits was about, why they did it, and why that makes Jesus so fantastic for us. Lord, we are thankful in Jesus' name. Amen. There are two Old Testament passages I want to use to focus in on as I start this sermon on first fruits. Starting first in Leviticus chapter 23, looking at how God's command was to bring in the first fruits. God's command to bring in the first fruits. And so far, I'm not getting this to work. So, Deb, you're going to have to help me there. Bringing in the first fruits. God commanded, and I'll read from Leviticus 23, 9 through 14. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, when you enter the land which I am going to give to you and gather its harvest, then you shall bring in the sheaf of the first fruits of the harvest to the priest. He shall wave the sheaf before the Lord for you to be accepted. On the day after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. Now on the day when you wave the sheaf, you shall offer a male lamb 1 year old without defect as a burnt offering to the Lord. Its grain offering shall be 2/10 of an ephah of fine flour mixed with oil, an offering by fire to the Lord for a soothing aroma, with its drink offering 1/4 of a hin of wine. Until this very day, until you have brought in the offering of your Lord, you shall neither eat bread nor roasted grain nor new produce. It shall be a permanent statute among your generations and all your dwelling places." In celebrating the harvest, God commanded them to bring in the best. Now, bring in the best. I never really fully understood that first fruits were the very best of the crop until I lived up in Oregon. Moved up in Oregon, over on the Oregon coast, and they had wild blackberries, and they are all over there. They considered a nuisance, but man, they taste good. And I remember every year when they started putting on the blackberries, the very best, the very tastiest, the sweetest of all were that first one on the very tip that would get ripe. And boy, that was the one. You picked that one when it got ripe and you ate that. It was juicy. It was sweet. It was fantastic. Now, the rest of them you'd pick and you put them into a bowl and cover them with sugar. But that first one, that was the best one there. And they were so much tastier. And you know, the other ones were good, but that one was the best. I've learned that it's even true with vegetables. You know, your first harvest of peas, the first harvest of the beans, they're often the plumpest and the tastiest ones. And God commanded the Israelites that when they get into the promised land, that he was going to give them the first fruits of the harvest. They were to gather them up and give to him because God deserves our very best. He desires our very best. And along with giving to God the first fruits, the very best also comes that it's going to be a step of faith that God will provide. That's a huge step of faith, really, to think about. If you give away the very best of the best, the first of your crop, there's no guarantee there's a second crop. There's no guarantee another harvest will happen. The locust could come in, a hailstorm could come in, frost, a heavy rain that would destroy the crops, invading armies, drought, all sorts of things could happen and destroy the rest of the crop. And so to give God the very first fruits, the very first that came out, was a huge step of faith that somehow God will provide. Even today, when we give to God our tithes and our offerings, and we give our first fruits, it's a huge step of faith. When we sit down, we've just been paid, and we give the immediate top 10%, the first fruits, to God, it's hard to do sometimes because we keep thinking in our minds, but there's rent, there's utilities, there's car payment, there's car insurance, there's this, there's this, there's this, and everything else just seems to be there, and we keep going, if I give God the first 10%, will I have enough for the rest of the month? Will I be able to pay the rest of my bills? How will it be taken care of? And the Israelites, as they were being brought out of Egypt, where all their needs had been supplied by their masters, by the Egyptians, now they were heading out into an unknown land, a place they'd never been, and they are told that when they get there, the very first harvest belongs to God. But wait a minute, what about us? God says, it's mine. It might have been easier for them to visualize and conceptualize when they first left Egypt, having never owned much as slaves in Egypt. But now after 40 years of wandering around in the wilderness and having a steady diet of manna, and more manna for every meal, every day, the idea of getting a harvest of fresh vegetables and fresh fruit probably was extremely tempting. I want that apple. I want that peach. I want that pear. I want that. And God says, the first of it's mine. God commanded them to give this first fruits in celebration, in remembrance of God's deliverance of them. A remembrance of God's deliverance. And that's what we find in Deuteronomy 26. Then it shall be when you enter the land which the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance, and you take possession of it and live in it, then you shall take some of the first of all the produce of the ground, which you bring in from your land, that the Lord your God gives you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place where the Lord your God chooses to establish his name. And you shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, I declare today to the Lord my God that I have entered the land which the Lord swore to give to our fathers to give to us. Then the priest shall take the basket from your hand and set it before the altar of the Lord your God, and you shall respond and say before the Lord your God, my father was a wandering Aramean, and he went down to Egypt and resided there, few in number, but he came there, he became a great, mighty, and populous nation. And the Egyptians treated us badly and oppressed us and imposed hard labor on us. Then we cried out to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice, and he saw our wretched condition, our trouble, and our oppression. And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand, an outstretched arm, and with great terror and with signs and wonders. And he has brought us to this place and has given us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And now behold, I have brought you the first of the produce of the ground, which you, Lord, have given me. Then you shall set it before the Lord your God and worship before the Lord your God. This was not a punishment to the Israelites to give the first fruits. It was to celebrate and to remember that God has power to deliver. God has power to deliver. When they brought the first fruits to the Lord, they were to remember their ancestral past, how they were very few in number, 70 of them. They went down into Egypt, how they were mistreated in Egypt, but somehow God, with his mighty hand, outstretched arm, he had the power to deliver them from the entire Egyptian army and their slavery to them. And this was a celebration of God's power to deliver, to bring them into a land that was flowing with milk and honey. And when we come before the Lord God to celebrate first fruits, to give to him our first fruits, we are to remember the awesome power of God to deliver us from the bondage of sin and set us free. And he has given us a promise of an eternity in heaven, and we're just giving back a small portion. This is a time to celebrate. And so much more so that, you know, those of us who are Christians, and Brother Jared's going to be sharing that in just a little bit while, about the great news and this detail here. Bringing in the first fruits was a remembrance of God's deliverance, having the power to deliver us, and that God can do great signs and wonders. God can do great signs and wonders. For the Israelites, they were to think back to the 10 plagues, the miraculous provision of them for the 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, daily being provided food, water, protection, guidance. For us, especially this weekend, Resurrection weekend, we remember the awesome power of God to do even greater signs and wonders because He raised up Jesus from the dead. Now, Brother Jared gets to come up and finish this sermon.
When Malcam discussed that he wanted to tag team the sermon, I agreed on the condition that we would wear matching wrestling tights. But he didn't want to be a stumbling block to you ladies, so, you know, thought that would be a good idea. some jokes you don't tell the guy ahead of time before you make them. So, if you've got a Bible, turn to 1 Corinthians 15. This is the part where Paul takes this holiday, this festival, and he co-opts it to something new. Now, we get to see it looking back. We're like, oh yeah, Jesus the first fruits. But this was not something that they had ever thought of before. Remember, in Acts 18, Paul goes to the city of Corinth, where this letter is written to later, and he starts by preaching in the synagogue. And he starts preaching to the people there, and they kind of reject him, kick him out. And then he goes literally next door, and he starts a church, which I think is hilarious, right? And then the leader of the synagogue is like, yeah, next door is pretty good. They serve bread. Let's go. You know. And so he goes next door, and he becomes a Christian, follower of the way. And now you fast forward. So there, actually, this church is made up of mostly Gentiles and some Jewish people. And then you fast forward 4 years later, and Paul writes this letter because he starts hearing things about what's happening in the church at Corinth. And so he wants to talk to these guys and make sure that they're on the right track. So in 15, verse 1, he says this, "Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word that I preached you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as first importance, that Christ died for your sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures." So he takes his time and he reminds them. Remember, guys, when I came and you first believed, remember what I taught you exactly. These things from Scripture, the most important things. That Christ was a man that died, was buried, and was resurrected. He came back. Right? And so then in verse 5 through 9, he talks about different people that saw Jesus when he was raised from the dead. Then I want to pick it down. Skip it down to verse 12. And this is where Paul kind of gets back into it. He says, if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say there's no resurrection of the dead? See, because the reason he wrote this letter was he heard some people had started corrupting the gospel and started getting it wrong and getting off track. Now, he doesn't call them heretics and tell them to get out of the church. Instead, he wants to correct them and bring them back. So he starts saying, don't forget, this is what we said. He has been resurrected. In verse 13, if there is no resurrection of dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless. And so is your faith. Ow, Paul. All right. More than that, we are found to be false witnesses about God. For we testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead, but he did not raise him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you're still in your sins. Then those of you who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people are most to be pitied. Wouldn't you love to have somebody tell you that your faith is futile and that you're to be pitied for it? Ouch. But I mean, that's some harsh words, but it's so true. Because if you've lost hope in the resurrection, then your faith is futile and it's so sad for you that you should be pitied on this thing. And so there, Paul just gives it to him straight. All right, in verse 20. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. And he drops this line on him. The first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. All right. the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through one man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through one man. For as in Adam all die, so Christ and all will be made alive. But each in turn, Christ the first fruits, then when he comes, those belong to him. So he says this, he drops this bomb, that Christ, the first fruits from the dead. That's the main point. Christ, the first fruits from the dead. He's telling them, and remember, this is a partly Jewish audience. So half these people, probably more, the Gentiles, are just like, fruits, yeah, right, we're all fruit. We're fruits? Wait, didn't you call me? And the rest of them have this enormous light bulb go off. Wait a minute. Christ is the first fruits? And they have all these different associations with this festival. Remember, this is something they've been celebrating their entire life. How many memories do you have tied to childhood Christmases? Right? Those special holidays. Or you remember, you smell, you ever walk in a room and a smell hits you and it takes you back to a memory? And it's like, wow, I haven't thought about that in years. See, these people have these amazing memories of things that they've done in years past. Growing up Jewish, they had these tactile sensory things tied to this idea of first fruits. And so when Paul drops this, Christ is the first fruits, their minds are just reeling. Christ is the first fruits, and they probably go back to what it was, exactly like what Malcolm said, that he's the best and the most important. Because instantly, they're recalling all those times growing up where they had to get the best. Remember, could you imagine being a kid and picking the fruit from your garden that you haven't eaten in a year? And you are with your folks and you said, oh, that, look at that apple, I can't wait to eat that. Said, no, that's the best apple. That one's for God. And remember those growing up, and so they have all these. And so instantly these people are thinking, wow, Christ is the best. He is the most important of the first fruits. And so instantly this flashes in their mind. All right, so he is the best, he is the most important. Now, what do you mean he is the most important? Because, and what is he the best? Because there was other people that have been raised from the dead, right? I mean, Lazarus, right? The story of Lazarus, and even before that, in Luke 7, Jesus raises the widow's son. And even if you don't have the New Testament account yet, you've got all the Old Testament stuff, like in 1 Kings 17, where the widow's son was raised. And so they, wait a minute, there have been other people who have been raised from the dead. What makes Jesus the best or the most important? See, all those other people, they escaped death for a little bit. But Jesus didn't escape death. Jesus conquered death. See, later in this chapter, Paul will quote back to a psalm, will kind of paraphrase it. He says, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? See, no longer, those people that were raised from the dead, they still had to face death later. Yet Jesus conquered it. And so that, therefore, making him the best and the most important, because he took away the sting of death. Amen, yeah. Now, there's one thing to do to say that you can do something, right? It's one thing to, like, you ever walk or you see somebody make something, you're like, that ain't no big thing. I can do that. Right, you walk into the bakery and you see these cupcakes, you're like, they're shaped like a caterpillar, and you're like, oh, you just put the cupcakes next to each other and caterpillar goes and frosting, anybody can do that, right? I mean, they have entire shows. One of my favorite shows to watch with the family is a show called Nailed It. And what it is, if you haven't seen it, they give these people on the show a cake and they give them a model. Can you show that first one? This is a model. So they say, here's the picture of this cake like this. It's a black cake, it's got a lot of words. So so there's these cakes, basically they show them like this. They say, okay, here, this is what you need to make. And of course, the people are like, no problem, that'd be easy, right? You got a cupcake with a green wrapper, some of that, you need a little fondant for the little egg, draw a little line on it. But then when they go to reveal what they've made, they turn out like this. Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall and it was really hot outside. like I like that the cupcake isn't even happy about how he looks. Like, he's frowning, right? Or they show him this one, right? Like, oh man, the Tiger King, this would be great, you know? Everybody got into that show, it was crazy. And so, like, yeah, we need to do this. Let's have a party, let's make a cake. And it turns out like this. Like, oh my gosh, that is what nightmares are made of, right there. Or, you know, you've got like a little girl and she wants a unicorn birthday cake for her party. Oh, a monkey, even better. And so they show him the monkey and, you know, it's this monkey like, oh, this would be great. Oh, it's just like, we'll make the cake in a bowl, we'll flip it upside down, and we'll put little like handle shapes for ears. And then you end up with this at your monkey party. You're so good, it melts your face off. That's how good this cake is, right? And so it's one thing, like, oh yeah, like Aunt Edna's like, no, I can make that cake. You know, you show her a picture off Pinterest, and she's like, I can do that. And, it, you know, talk is cheap, right? But can when she shows up with your monkey cake that looks like it's gonna give you nightmares, then you start to wonder, maybe I shouldn't do that anymore. See, the thing is, God didn't say that he could raise us from the dead. He gave us Christ, the first fruits, and as a guarantee. He is the guarantee of our resurrection. See, Christ could say, or God could say, like, oh, yeah, I'll raise you from the dead. And then he's on the back Googling, like, how do you raise somebody from the dead? You know, but God didn't do that. God guaranteed it by leading with Jesus, by raising Jesus from the dead. And if you read those passages that we skipped over, it talks about how Jesus appeared to 500 people and to certain people on, and all these different details in 1 Corinthians 15. So go back and read that. And it is our guarantee that God can do what he says. He's not like Aunt Edna saying he can bake that cake. He did it. And so he is a guarantee. Christ is a guarantee. He also is the proof. He is the proof God has power to deliver us. He is a proof that he's that. See, the Israelites were commanded to obey the first fruit festival, to do this, to remember that God delivered them out of a life of slavery in Egypt into a life where they were a nation that belonged to God. He took them from having nothing to possessing the promised land. Now, Paul co-opts this festival where they were supposed to remember, and he says, I want you to remember that God can deliver. And all the people are like, oh yeah, God can deliver. We remember that. He's like, no. God can deliver you, not out of slavery to other people, but God has the power to deliver you out of the slavery to sin. God has the power to deliver you out of death until a resurrected life, just like Christ, where we be reunited with him. And that is a reason that we can party. That is a reason that we meet on Sunday mornings instead of Friday nights. Because we don't have to have a Savior that was in the grave. But instead, we celebrate because of the empty tomb. Now, there is this moment where so many of us, our time, this is the day that we look forward to because we get to celebrate the fact that we have hope in his resurrection, that we will be joined with him in his resurrection. And if you're that way, if you've put your faith in Christ, then wow, this is a day to party. This is a day to reflect and remember and just rejoice that Christ is the first fruits of our resurrection. But you might be at a place where you haven't accepted and you're thinking, man, I want that hope that these people have. I want that guarantee of that salvation, of that unity with Christ in life after this life. And if it's that case, we're going to open it up for a time of invitation. We're going to sing a song together. And if you want to make that decision, I invite you to come forward and talk to me. If you're not ready to make that decision, I'll be hanging out afterwards too. But let's go ahead and sing together as we can celebrate.